So welcome you all. So today we are going to be discussing on a topic which is extremely interesting and something which we can all connect to, on enriching life, enriching our life through empowerment. And many of you, people must be coming to you for some advice and all that. You could be the go-to person, or sometimes you are wondering, how do I, why do I get so emotionally caught up? How do I, solve this? Can somebody empower me? Can I be an empowered person? So today we will, Dr. Ali will be discussing with us on empowerment, both self as well as reaching out to others. As you all know, Dr. Ali is the go-to person for maybe 1 million lives have been impacted with his workshops, under his training. We have 4,500 counselors who are trained under him, and he's written many books, more than 100 booklets and books on human behavior, on relationships. So who better than him to tell us about empowerment, both self as well as to reach out to others. So here's Dr. Ali, and we begin our program.
Very good morning to all of you. I don't know about you, but I am definitely feeling enriched. The last few weeks particularly, I feel, have been those, where like the people who suffer from something like addictions and all that, they say that you have to hit rock bottom and then you give a kick to the bottom and then you start going up. I think few weeks back we hit rock bottom. We were all shaken up and we were all wondering what happened to life here. Here I was looking for, promotions or buying a new gadget or a new house. Here I was looking forward to my child's future. Here I was thinking of so many things, summer vacations and this and that. Everything went for a six, and we went all the way down, lock down. Then what happened? As it always happens, the old proverb came into play, and that is, this too shall pass. It hasn't passed. Okay. So what do we need to do? Do we wait, as some people are saying? Let us wait till a vaccine comes. Let us wait till this whole thing is done. I'm reminded of the wisdom of Swami Vivekananda. You know what he said? There was this young man who had to cross a river and go to his destination. And a lot of good things awaited him there. He went very enthusiastically till he reached the river. And he saw that river was in great spate. He saw that the current was very strong and he got scared. He said, what if I lose my foothold in this river and I get drowned or I get swept away? No. I think what I'll do is, I will wait till all the river water flows past, and once all the water is gone, I'll cross over. I think some of us are waiting for that. And let me tell you, it will not happen. It will never happen. None of you were alive at that time, but you can ask your grandfathers if they're alive. Something like, let's say, Second World War, when it broke out. Things went from bad to worse. Things kept going down and down and down. The Allies, which we were part of, the British, felt that we are going to lose. And our country, our lives, everything will be gone. And then what happened? Slowly the tide turned. And then we came back. The war was over. Not only was the war over for the victors, eventually the war got over for the losers also, who were on the other side of the war. Italy, Germany, Japan. They rose up like phoenix. They became wonderful economies. They became very trusted and respected countries in the world. And today nobody even looks at countries like Japan or Germany and says, hey, these were the culprits who fought the Second World War. It's all over, done with. I have seen similar situations in my life also. That is one thing I wanted to share with you, that enriching life is in our hands. We have to enrich our lives. We cannot wait till some vaccine comes or till the lockdown is completely lifted or till schools reopen or something of that sort. It will take time. It will happen. It cannot be permanently out, isn't it? Life cannot come to a standstill till the day life actually comes to a standstill, and then it will be too late. Then you won't be able to do anything about it, right? Okay. So, let's talk. There are two key words in today's topic: enriching and empowerment. Let me start with the first one, that is enriching. What do we mean by enriching? Is it riches? Is it a heavy bank balance? Is it a fantastic salary? Is it a good business or whatever it is, so that I can say I'm rich? Look at the type of assets and wealth and this and that I've got. No. I hope you at least understand and accept that. That however much you may earn, however rich you may be in terms of richness, money, wealth, assets, there's no end to it. So that is not a definition of enriching, right? It has to go somewhere beyond that. So what do we mean? A simple way thing would be a person who does not have very great wants. Everybody has wants. I want food, I want ice cream, I want to see a movie, I want to wear good clothes, I want to have good relationship. We all have wants. But anyone whose wants are not so desperate, the person doesn't feel that without these wants, I'm a nobody and I'm left with nothing. That is the rich person. And I want to differentiate here between wants and needs. Needs are real. Wants are within us. I need, let's say a person at my stage and age of life, I need a vehicle. I can't go walking from one end of the city to the other. Public transport is not too convenient for a person like me. So I need a vehicle, right? That is a need. But I may want to have a fantastic high-end Mercedes or BMW or something of that sort, state of the art with all the gadgetry and this and that. That is a want. Please start differentiating between your needs and wants. That's what even Mahatma Gandhi had said to us. There's everybody for people's, there is enough in our country. Our country is not poor. There's enough in our country for everybody's needs, but there isn't enough for people's greed, he put it. So when wants exceed a certain factor, a certain point, they become greed. And a greedy person will never be rich. He will always be poor because he will always be counting what he doesn't have instead of counting what he has. Whereas a person who says, I have some wants, if I get it, I'll be very happy. But if I don't get it, I'm still fine with is happening to you. Now those who keep worrying. I mentioned this earlier, I'm repeating it again. The greatest pandemic that has hit us today is fear. Those of us who have got engulfed in this, fear, who are worrying from morning to night, the first thing that we are doing is looking at numbers, how many people died, how many people positive, how many people recovered, how many in Italy, how many in Germany, and that sort of things. Those are the type of people who are going to be very deeply in trouble, because if one pandemic goes away, another one comes. Just go back into history. That's why I keep reminding everybody, not just students but even adults, that if you hate history, if you neglect history, then history repeats itself. It comes back to you. So please understand that you need to stop worrying, and that is within your control. How do you do that? There are some great psychologists, you know, who I have always admired and who I have followed. One of them happens to be this little, you know, bald-headed kid whom we know as Charlie Brown. You know what Charlie Brown says about worrying? Have a look. Worrying won't stop the bad stuff from happening. It just stops you from enjoying the good. Do you agree with me? So it's in your hands. A person who worries, a person who perpetually thinks of his wants, can never be a rich person. So start off on this journey. This is the right time. As I told you, we have hit rock bottom and we are coming up. Whatever anybody may say, that cases are increasing and more people are dying and whatever is happening, more people have always been dying. If people had stopped dying, there would have been no place on this earth for us to be born and to live over here, isn't it? So please understand that ups and downs will happen. Tsunamis will hit us. Riots will hit us. Pandemics will hit us. All sorts of things will happen. Life moves on, but the quality of life, are you a rich person, depends on your attitude towards life. One of the greatest riches, I would say, is to have at least one or two or three people who are very close to you and with whom you share such a warm and close relationship that you will not even realize, you know, how much they contribute to you. There are these, you know, people who play a very significant role in what you are and your quality of life. But unfortunately, many of them take us for granted. I may go to work, I may put in a lot of hard work and efforts and these and stress and tension, I come back home. I have one or two very loving, caring family members who do the smallest of gestures to me without even asking me. They know what I want. They don't stop with the needs. They also know what I want. They ask me what I want or they guess what I want. And they endeavor to fulfill those little wants. Now, if I have nurtured such relationships, I am a rich person. So please reflect on the type of relationship that you had. And again, like Charlie Brown said, don't worry about what you don't have. Let's say I have a very bad relationship with somebody very close to me, my spouse, my parent, my child, whoever it is. It happens. Sometimes, despite my best efforts, I do not have good relationships with that one person who is very important to me and who is probably going to be attached to me the rest of my life. But my relationship with that person is not good. As Charlie Brown said, do I look at the other relationships? Do I look at other relationships? Or do I focus only on the negative ones? That is what I want you to understand. Can I not cherish, enjoy a good warm relationship which I have with person B instead of person A? And remember, person B need not be a defined relationship, need not be my family member, need not be my parent, sibling, spouse, child. It may be somebody who has no defined relationship with me, but who gives me unconditional love, who cares for me, who is there to reach out to me in the smallest possible ways. This is what enriches. As I have always been saying, the definition of mental health starts with being at peace within yourself. Ask yourself this question. Despite all the bad things that happen, somebody passes away, somebody falls sick, some threats are there, some financial crisis takes place, all those things keep happening. There are times when I'm really disturbed. There are times when I'm extremely upset. There are times that I may not sleep the whole night. There are times when I may be very irritable and very angry. But as long as I treat it as what behavioral scientists say, transient situational disturbance. Transient situational disturbance. It's transient, number one. That means it is temporary. It is because of a situation that has occurred. I am not labeling somebody as bad. I am not saying this person is responsible. I am saying the situation is bad. And that is causing me a disturbance. I am disturbed. It is temporary. It is a situation that has been created and I am disturbed. Fair enough. By its very definition, a transient situational disturbance can change. It is transient. This too shall pass. Situation never remains the same. Situation keeps changing. A different situation can bring in different things. So, the disturbance will pass away when the situation changes, because it is transient. If I understand that, and if I can truthfully tell myself that at least 70, 80, 90% of the time I am at peace within myself. I need not be having excellent relationships with all my near and dear. Sometimes relationships can go very bad also. Doesn't matter. But within me, am I at peace within myself? Then I am a rich person. I am enriched. That is how life, you know, goes on. One of the simplest ways to assure that you feel enriched, you feel that yes, life is good for me, is to build, strengthen and sharpen your life skills. Life skills, we are very lucky to be born in a generation where life skills have been very clearly defined. Three great, you know, developments took place towards the end of 20th century, which are far more greater for humanity than all the progress that took place in the IT world and the space and, you know, medical sector and all that. Yet we don't give importance to them. Today I want you to start thinking deeper into those. What are those three? The first one was Howard Gardner's multiple intelligences. He brought out to us the fact that intelligence is not one straight line. A person who can do mathematical sums very easily cannot play music. A person who plays music cannot necessarily write well. A person who can express himself very well need not be a good auditor or calculator or whatever it is. A person who is good in technology need not be good in medicine and vice versa. So we started understanding from the 1980s that every human being has multiple intelligences. And if we nurture and sharpen those intelligences, then things become better. It is almost 30-35 years since those theories were propounded by Howard Gardner. How much importance are we giving to that? Almost 10 years later, Daniel Goleman came out. Came out meaning he brought it to the common man. It did exist before that also, but he brought to the common man the concept of emotional intelligence, the emphasis on emotional intelligence as contrasted to the IQ, the intelligence quotient which we were measuring for the last 100 years. We still continue to measure it, of course. Intelligence quotient is, in simple words, the buddhi, cognitive intelligence. How fast can I grasp when somebody is talking to me, when somebody is explaining something to me? How quickly can I calculate and find out what is plus minus, which is better, take decisions? How good I am at the logical level, sequential level, analytical level, all these things contribute towards my cognitive intelligence, buddhi, which we refer to as IQ, intelligence quotient. Now what is emotional quotient? Emotional quotient is the complement to that. Being able to handle good relationships, being able to communicate well, being able to formulate the right words, being able to think outside the box, having good kinesthetic ability, what your mind says, your body should respond to that, being intuitive, having a sixth sense, and of course being able to manage your emotions. Now we had moved one step forward. The third came in towards the end of the 20th century, and that is the life skills as propounded by WHO, World Health Organization. 10 years of work went into 10 years of work went into it, and at the end of it, a report was published by World Health Organization. And I want to tell you very proudly that the chief editor of that final report was an Indian, a Bangalorean, one of my teachers, Dr. R. Srinivas Murthy, who was formerly professor of psychiatry and dean at NIMHANS. He was deputed to Geneva, WHO, and he was instrumental in bringing out this final report. This report is more than 20 years old. What have we done with it? Even when supposedly things were going well and everything was fine, and you know, we had wonderful things going, we were not giving it importance. We still stuck to our old Macaulay system of education, learning, understanding, right up to B schools. What did they teach? They said, this is a case study, this is how this happens, organizational behavior, something, something, project management and all that. But did they look at the right brain part of it? Did they look at the emotional part of the thing? No. Very little, at least. On the other hand, behavioral scientists have told us 80% of our happiness, fulfillment and this and that will be done by our emotional intelligence. Maybe 10 or 20% of our success and our fulfillment will depend on our IQ. Today, an individual with low IQ, buddhi, you have to explain things to him 10 times before he understands. He can't do calculations, he cannot write properly, he cannot express himself with the literary word and things of that sort. Even he can overtake a person who is highly educated and doing exceedingly well in his academics, because 80-90% of his fulfillment and all that will depend on the EQ. Based on these type of things, what are we doing to enrich ourselves? That is where the question comes. Now, in between, while all this was going on and we were neglecting it and we were not giving it importance, in came this Mr. Corona. Or is it Miss Corona? I'm not sure. Doesn't matter. Now this Corona thingy came in, and life, as I said, was disturbed. I think, you know, this Corona seems to be a woman, again back to Charlie Brown, because Charlie Brown has something very interesting to say about this coronavirus. Have a look. She's asking, what surprises you most about this coronavirus? And Charlie Brown says, it has done what no woman has been able to do. Cancel all sports, shut down all bars, and keep men at home. Thanks, Charlie Brown. So comes this question of empowerment. Coronavirus has empowered us in certain ways, but it's a visitor, it's going to go away, as I said. If you don't believe me, ask your elders. 30 years back, when HIV/AIDS first struck this world globally, started in Africa or somewhere, and slowly started spreading. Initially we said, no, that's for Africa and this and that, we are not bothered, we ignored it. Then they said, how is HIV/AIDS spreading? They said, primarily by homosexual activity. Ha! We are not homosexuals, so how are we bothered? We don't care for this HIV/AIDS. And then we slowly realized that HIV/AIDS can strike anybody. And as I said, you can ask people who are elders who lived through that phase 30 years back. They will tell you that people had stopped going to barbers because they were told that if the barber uses a blade to shave somebody or to, you know, cut the whatever hair and happens to cut somebody and touches that blood, and that person incidentally happens to be HIV positive, now that blade gets that HIV germ. And you are the next person, the barber comes and, you know, shaves you and cuts you, and that HIV germ goes inside you. Mind you, the blade has to cut the first person, blood has to come out. The blade has to cut you and blood has to come out. And that person should be HIV positive. Look at the statistics. But what happened? People stopped going to barbers. Or the first thing they would go to a barber is, go and see how is your blade. Only if you're using a new blade, I'll do. People used to carry their blades with them. That was the type of fear. Subsequently, what happened? There were two very important things about HIV and AIDS. I want you to compare it with corona. The first is that it took anywhere between 3 to 6 months for a person to actually be identified as HIV positive. That means today, if I acquired the HIV virus, it would show up in a test only 6 months from now, 1 month from now, 2 months from now. If I go to a lab and get myself tested also, it won't show. So there was this huge contingent of people who are HIV positive and who are roaming around all over the place, and nobody could guess that they are HIV positive. The second thing is, HIV positive not only did not have a cure at that time, it still doesn't have a cure 30 years down the line. 35 million people have been affected by HIV. 3.5 million out of those have died with painful deaths, lingering deaths, withering away. Out of that 35 million, at least 1/4 of them are still on medication. And they will be on medication lifelong, and they'll never be able to go back to that healthy life which they had led earlier. But do you see anybody today scared of HIV/AIDS? Nobody. Subsequently, we got H1N1, we got dengue, we got so many things. Nobody is scared about that. One very sad upcoming film actor commits suicide, and for the next 72 hours, everybody is talking about depression and suicide. And then everybody forgets about it. So here is where this second part of today's discussion comes in, and that is empowerment. How do we empower ourselves and how do we empower others to enrich our lives? Go far beyond HIV or dengue or, you know, our latest pandemic of corona or some tsunami or some floods or whatever. It is. Recently, 3-4 lakhs of people were uprooted from their houses in West Bengal and Odisha because of the flood. Can you imagine the type of lives that they are leading? Millions of migrant labor suffered so badly for weeks after the lockdown. And with great difficulty, many of them managed to reach home. And we are already hearing in the media that we are now trying to get them back to the cities. Please come. Our work has come to a standstill. You don't care for their lives? Don't you think that they are risking themselves by doing this? But then what happens to our basic needs, our amenities, our this, our that? They are the ones who are running all this, no? So we want them back. We'll run trains for them. There have been instances where flights have been arranged for them. Those poor fellows who had to walk back home in the horrible summer are being provided a plane to come back to work because they are needed by their employers. That is not empowerment. And if we deal with people in this manner, if we become selfish and say, I will care only for my family. I will care only for my children. I'll care only for my elderly parents. And yet, I want the electricity on, I want the water supply and the sewerage, I want the parkarmikas and the municipal fellows to keep cleaning up my locality. I want all the medical staff, from doctors, nurses, lab assistants, everybody to be on duty if I need any medical help. I want the taxis to be available if I need to go somewhere. Those people are not human beings. Those people don't have families. Those people are not, you know, succumbing to pandemic or the corona. Now this defeats empowerment. Empowerment has to be a process where you take everybody along. How do you do that? You heard of this wonderful proverb which says, you can take a horse to the water, but you cannot make him drink. Right from my childhood, I've been hearing this proverb, and everybody nods their head. Everybody says, yeah, yeah, that is true. I disagree. I think you can make the horse drink. How? That is where empowerment comes in. Can you motivate that horse to drink? Can you make him understand the benefits of drinking water? Can I go over there and have a drink of water and say, ah, I feel nice, soothed, and my thirst is over? The horse watches you. Can I explain very gently and nicely to the horse? Can I lift up a cup of water and bring it nearer to his mouth? There are ways and means of making the horse drink. Why do we give up by saying you can take the horse to the water but you cannot? That's a very self-defeating type of statement, no? Why don't we aim at empowerment of others? Take away the fears from them. Be a good role model to them. Discuss with them. Ask them what is happening. Look at the various alternatives to do things. As I said, the greatest empowerment is through life skills. The more you learn life skills, the more empowered you are, whether it is children or whether it's your very elderly parents. Everybody needs life skills. So what do we do? We imbibe life skills, where we are constantly debating whether children should go to school or whether they should have online classes or whether online classes are also bad for their health. We are debating all that. Fine. As I said, this too will pass. One day this debate will be over. People will be back to their routine. But today, when we have so much of time, when families are sitting together with so much of time on their hands, so much cohesion, so much closeness to each other, because we are socially distancing ourselves from everybody else today, are we empowering ourselves, our parents, our domestic help, our children, all these people in terms of life skills? Now, I have been working on life skills almost from the time when it was published, because Dr. Murthy had sent me an advance copy when the report was being published from Geneva, and he had taken a few inputs and all that. So from that time, I have been absolutely fascinated with this concept of life skills. I held many seminars, not webinars, but seminars in those good old days. Got in the topmost experts to talk to us about how life skills can be imbibed and how life skills can be enhanced. This is a mission which I will continue whether there is a pandemic or not. In fact, next Saturday, we are going to focus on life skills. We are going to start with that. I have already started formulating a quick, maybe a 10-session program, a webinar, for parents, not children. You want to keep children away from the screen, I'm happy, in fact. But parents anyway have to be on it. Many of you are spending 8 hours, 12 hours a day in front of your laptops. Your profession, your work demands that. So another couple of hours in a week is not going to make too much effect on your health. But we will teach parents who are interested some very simple and nice techniques of how to imbibe life skills into the children. Whether they complete their biology portion and whether they learn the grammar and whether they are good in mathematics problems and all that, that you, the education is teachers, let them, you know, tackle that. My concern is about empowerment, starting with adults, but primarily also going to the younger generation. Children also need to be empowered. And this is one thing that, you know, we are focusing on and we are going to do. I want all of you to get into that thing. Today, if you have extra time with your child, you may be helping your child with the studies, you may be playing board games with them, you may be encouraging your child to learn cooking or learn dancing or whatever, it is fine. All that is there. But can you take out some time to empower your children, your family members, whoever is interested in doing it, in teaching them basic life skills? This is a wonderful opportunity because, as I said, this too shall pass. People will get busy. Daddy will be commuting 3 hours, 4 hours a day to his workplace. Children will be getting up in the morning and rushing to the school bus and coming back with homework and all these type of things. Before we go into that, this is the right time to get into, you know, building up and sharpening our life skills. And that empowerment is something like that. Again, a very old proverb which I do believe in. Instead of feeding fish to a person, teach him fishing. A person is hungry and you provide him fish, presuming of course that he is a non-vegetarian. You give him some fish and he will thank you, he will bless you, he will say, my stomach is full, I am very happy, he will probably go and sleep it off. Next day he will be hungry, and then what happens? In fact, he will be dependent on you. He will come running back to you and say, sir, today I am more hungry, sir, please give me some fish to eat. But if you decide to teach him fishing, every time that he is hungry, all he needs to do is to go to the river, pond, whatever it is, catch a fish, cook it and eat. He will never have to be hungry. That is what I am talking about at the emotional and the mental level. There's a lot of talk and lot of emphasis that learning should be including the social and emotional aspects. Some great experts have already done wonderful work in that. The Teacher Foundation, for example, in Bangalore. NIMHANS has done excellent work on these things. Now, these are the things that need to be done to look at learning, empowerment, growth beyond things like curriculum or subjects or academics. In fact, as you know, the exams of CBSE and ICSE have been cancelled. There are children who are thrilled. They are jumping up and down and catching hold of their mobiles and running away into their room, and that's the end of it there. Now they are telling their parents, don't bug me, all these days you are bugging me saying that board exams. Now there's no board exams and they are going to give me based on my earlier marks. Even though my earlier marks are not good, what can I do about it? And they are happy. They need to learn life skills. That life doesn't stop with end of exams. They need to be taught that life is a little more than just appearing and, you know, getting marks in the exam. They have to understand the depth. That is the empowerment that we need to give to such children. There's another huge segment of children who are stunned, who are numb, who are saying, after all these efforts, under lockdown, we had nothing else to do, so we studied, 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 and we were told that in a week our board exams are starting, and here we are caught off. Even more so because in a state like Karnataka, the SSLC board exams are going on. Now the really hard-working children who are in SSLC are going to study very hard and they are going to get their 80, 90, 99, whatever percentage. The CBSE and the ICSE children are going to say that, how do we compete with these guys? I am equally competent. Given a chance, I would have studied and I would have also got good marks, but I was deprived of this thing. To counter all this, we are doing a webinar next Thursday at 11 o'clock. I would like children who are confused as to what happens and how do they take it forward. And I would like parents who are concerned about their children, whether your child is happy and enjoying or whether your child is upset and is getting confused about what is happening. Either way, we will have a discussion on that. So each of these things we are taking up as our small sense of responsibility or whatever you want to call it. Now, I want to have an open house and discuss a lot of things with you. But before that, one last quote from our great philosopher, Charlie Brown. We live only once. Here is Snoopy, who seems to be a greater philosopher than Charlie Brown, because Charlie Brown says, "We only live once, Snoopy." And Snoopy the dog says, "Wrong. We only die once. We live every day." I think Snoopy should be given a PhD. Do you agree? We die only once. We live every day. We are not dead. Even if I am COVID positive, I am not dead. I can very proudly tell you that one of my students became COVID positive. She, her husband and son, three of them, they were one of the first patients. For 2 days she suffered very badly. Her throat was so bad that she thought she's dying. Slowly she started recovering from there. The treatment got over. She's COVID negative. 3-4 days back she was in the office, all smiles, saying, "Hey Ali, can I help anybody who needs counseling or whatever it is?" She's living. She's living a better quality of life than what she led before. 2 days, she was miserable. 15 days after that, she was under treatment, lockdown, whatever, this, that. And that's it. That is what I want all of you to, you know, see. Can we go back up? I'd like to see the, there were a few questions I'd like to answer.
I can read it out to you, Ali.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. So, Sudha says, "Ali, there is a dilemma for me. I used to provide drinking water to all BBMP workers.
Hats off to you, Sudha.
In my compound from years. Now, 7 of them are positive with corona. My maid servant does not want them coming in my compound for 2 days. I have cold and cough. I'm worried about my family members. What to do?"
No, I do understand, Sudha, when those who are COVID positive definitely should not be coming in your compound, and I don't think they would be on duty. They would be in quarantine, they would be in hospital, particularly if they are, you know, COVID warriors, in the sense that they have been, you know, doing such diligent work. All of us have seen in each locality how those parokarmikas and all these people have been working. So we need to definitely insulate ourselves, maintain a distance. But while doing that, whatever else you can do, even if you collect some old bottles of drinking water, fill up nice clean water and keep it just at your on your compound and say, pick it up and go, or whatever it is. So we can minimize the contact, and don't involve your maid servant, because she also must be scared. She may be a family woman, she may be a mother, she may be scared about all these things. Respect her wishes. But if you, as a person who has been doing so much for them, can, you know, make out different methods of doing it, this is what is important. There are always ways and means of tackling these things. Why are we thinking of COVID as a death sentence? Today, even a, you know, very serious ailment like cancer is no longer a death sentence. People have recovered from cancer and are living happily lives for 10 years, 20 years now. So what is this COVID? What is so great about it? There are so many people who are asymptomatic. They go through COVID and they don't even feel the pain or anything, and then they recover and they come back. That is what we need to look at.
Yeah, Ali, Lata is saying, acceptance is the key. Happiness is something which cannot be found but experienced from within.
Wonderful. I 100% agree. We have to experience that. Yes, Anjali is asking how to come over the stigma about being detected with virus. Guess being contacted is more dangerous than the stigma. Yes, there will always be people like that. See, we work with special children. Let's say a child is autistic or spastic. There are people who refuse to come close to that child and touch that child because they think that their child is suffering from some mental illness and that is contagious. How do we take care of such people? We can't. Let them be, doesn't matter. Let us look for those people who are broad-minded, who are willing to accept. And let us encourage them. Let us empower any individual, like this student of mine, who says that, yes, here I am, whatever it is, I don't care. That is what I want all of us to do.
Ali, Alice is saying, we are searching for happiness in materialistic things. If things happen according to me, I'm happy. If not, it makes me sad. We have to come out of this.
Very true. I agree with you. Things can never, statistically speaking, things can never happen all the time as per your wishes, isn't it? And if things started going by your wishes all the time, then it will get boring. You will lose the value of it. A person who has crores and crores of rupees stashed in the his bank balance, and if he does some assignment or some project, and if he earns a lakh of rupees, it doesn't give him any happiness. But you ask a daily wage worker or somebody like that, or a petty shopkeeper, if he gets a lakh of rupees, his day, week, month and year is made, isn't it? Navina is asking how to empower a teenage child who is having fear of having COVID because he thinks of having interacted with a COVID friend. If the fear is very, very strong, get him tested. But in most cases, even that is not necessary. From your side, watch out for symptoms. And tell him also, do you have a sore throat? Do you have a cough? Do you have temperature? Now, most of us have got this. You have a thermometer at home, you can check it. In places like offices and all that, we have also acquired that handheld thermometer. Now, anybody walks into Banjara, we first put it to his forehead and we check his temperature. It's a small precaution. It's not inconveniencing anybody. It takes 10-15 seconds. But we tell them it's for your good and for my good. So start doing things of that sort. Secondly, please get away this general fear, not only from a teenage child, but from every one of us, that this is some horrible monster which is coming to eat us up. Nothing of that sort. Slowly we have to work towards it.
Yali, Madhumita saying, she's asking how to deal with the situation post the lockdown, primarily because it may lead to a rebound madness to recover from a sense of loss.
Yes, exactly. I am more concerned about the mental health of people than about the number of people who are dying. I mean, I don't want to sound very callous, but please look at the statistics. 100 people die of corona and the whole country is making a hue and cry. 300 people, according to official statistics, commit suicide in the country every day. And I don't think that is the correct number, because so many suicides go unreported. What are we doing about these thousands of people who are dying every day? Miserable deaths, going lower and lower and down and down and down in their mental state, till finally they feel that the life is just not worth it and they end their life. Are we doing anything about it? Very little, very, very little. Each one of us can do something in that area.
Ali, Mahima is asking that, yes, we are not taught empowering and things like this in the normal academics.
Yes.
So if one wants to learn it a little in a simplistic way, are there any tools you can help out?
Yes. The simplest way is what we are going to start after next Saturday's webinar, where we are going to announce, as I told you, a very short, crisp and practical program. Tentatively, it may be, let's say, 10 sessions of 1 hour each, spread over, let's say, 5 weeks or something. We're just formulating the details. Where we'll give you these practical inputs, which have not been given to you, I agree. We'll give it to you. You practice it for 2-3 days, come back for the next session, then we'll continue with that. So from our side, that's what we are doing. On the other hand, you want to buy our, Nimans has brought out very good handbooks, class-wise, for 7th standard, 8th standard, 9th standard, on inculcating life skills to the children. That was aimed at teachers, that was aimed at schools. I don't know how many schools have actually purchased those handbooks and are doing it on a regular basis. Some of them are doing. I'm very happy that some schools have taken it up. But there's a number of schools who are not doing it or who are doing it very half-heartedly. But as people concerned about children, let us take this responsibility and do it.
Ali Dharmish is saying, today or tomorrow, Corona will infect anyone and everyone. Only things that can help us is empowering ourselves with good behavior that will decrease our risk of contracting the virus.
Absolutely right. Absolutely right. And Dharmish, being a doctor and that too a community medicine specialist, he knows better than most of us about all these things. Let's talk to such people. If we have fear, there are experts all over the place. Let's talk to people who are knowledgeable. Let's read up, you know, information which is reliable, and let us look at things realistically. And yes, definitely take precautions. As I told you, we have already started that anybody entering, we don't allow anybody without a mask to come into the office. We maintain social distancing. We have kept a sanitizer right outside, whether they have used their own or not. We say once more, please sanitize, and we check their temperature. And then they come in, they do their work, whatever they want, counseling, whatever else they want, they do it. And they go back, and none of us are feeling threatened that people are coming in and that we'll acquire. You see, we had a visitor yesterday, day before, who was coughing very badly. So we requested him, we said that why don't you go back home and rest and see how things are and things of that sort. And he went back and he checked out. He actually got himself tested and he turned out to be negative. So we were also happy that, you know, that little risk that such a person had come into our this thing. And his sister called up and said that we got him checked and he is negative. That's it. These are the precautions to be taken.
Anupama is saying, we are physically quarantined, not mentally. Yes. Let's find ways to help each other in these times.
Wonderful statement. I agree. And we should not be mentally quarantined. That is the beauty of it. Nobody can control your mind. It is you who are passing these quarantine laws to yourself mentally. Please break those bars.
Seema had asked in the starting that Banjara has trained nearly 4,500 counselors. So, yeah. I mean, can a counselor enrich or, you know, empower people, if you can help me out?
The whole process of counseling is like that. The whole process of counseling is not to give advice, not to take decisions and not to do anything of that sort, but to empower the person. And empower them towards what? Let's even be very, you know, clear about that. Empowering the person to either resolve or cope with the issues or challenges that he is facing. If there is a solution, like we have been discussing, there are alternatives. Children who are locked up at home and they don't want to be sent out, we can teach them life skills. We can do activities which will help them to understand what is life, relationships, emotions and all that. So there are ways and means of resolving certain things. Let's take what cannot be resolved. The counselor helps the individual to cope with it. Even that is empowerment, according to me.
Ali Archana is saying, I feel some of our irresponsible media is contributing more to this fear factor.
Yeah.
How do we handle this?
We boycott media which is irresponsible. It's not very difficult to find out whether it's a TV, whether it's social media, whether it's a newspaper. Once, twice, three times you see that this people seem to be talking things which are rabble-rousing, as they say, you know, just trying to create fears and this and that. We boycott, we tell all our friends, please boycott, do not listen to them, do not believe in whatever they are saying. It's not very difficult. And once they realize that there are people like you who do not subscribe to their, you know, scandal-mongering, they themselves will come online.
Naveena is saying, also should we talk to the child and apart from testing, address the emotions of the child and his feelings?
Yes, yes, yes. In fact, as I told you, testing may or may not be necessary if the child is totally asymptomatic just because he has, you know, played with a friend or something and then he's got fear. That's not enough reason even for testing. Observe the child closely, as I said, temperature or sore throat or any of those sort of things. Then, of course, you get it tested. But much, much more important than that is what you said just now, that is, address the emotions and the fears. Even I started off by saying, tackle the fear. Among all the emotions, fear is the most overwhelming emotion that is hitting large volumes of people.
Yeah, Ali, Saida is saying, negative words affect mental health.
Absolutely, if we allow them to affect.
And how?
Again, we come back to the empowerment factor. I am not going to allow this to happen. I will rise above that. Just 2 days back, one of my relatives was panicking in the evening after we had gone home and all that, was saying, I just heard news that Koramangala and Malleshwaram and Rajaji Nagar and Yelahanka, they've all been locked down. SSLC exams have been cancelled and this and that. I just listened 2 minutes to that person and said, okay, tomorrow morning we'll get the correct news, because I subscribe to 2 newspapers which I feel are not, rumor mongering. Whatever they have to say, we'll see. What is it? No, aren't you afraid? Aren't you scared? I said, no, I'm not scared. We will see what it is. And I told her also that what is the reliability of your news that you are coming and talking, you know, in such an agitated manner. She cooled down and she went back, and sometime later she called up and said, sorry, I think they are misleading us. I said, now you learnt a lesson. Next time, please don't follow these things. Listen to people. Yes, some threat, some danger comes. We should always listen to them, but verify what is the reality.
Anjali saying, I want to know more about the 10 sessions.
Yes, Anjali, I know. Give us a little time. Next Saturday, our webinar is going to focus on this, and hopefully by the time everything will be ready, all the details and everything, we will pass it on to you. We'll put it up on our Facebook page and our website and all those things. So within a week, we'll be ready with that.
Ali, there's also then one more very curious question, that would a counseling session also be online, or how is it?
Yes, like we are doing a lot of counseling sessions online. It is steadily increasing, and it has steadily increased much before the lockdown or corona came in. Banjara Academy's online counseling, which we refer to as My Counselor. If you go to our website, you'll see a button called My Counselor. Every day, even before this pandemic came in, we were averaging anywhere between 20, 30, 40 people writing to us per day, and some of them from different countries outside India, many of them whose location we did not know where they are writing from, and we didn't ask them. But what we know is that they used to say that I'm so happy that somebody is offering this free service, and that too in confidentiality, because I don't have to disclose my identity, and I know that I'm getting this solace. I'm not trying to boast, but so many people have written back saying that it was such a wonderful experience that when I felt absolutely lonely, believe me, almost on a daily basis we get somebody who is so depressed that the person is thinking of suicide. Those are the people whom we reach out to, which can be done online. And of course, even on telephone, we get a lot of phone calls from people. And same thing, we don't ask for their identity, we don't ask for their, contact or anything of that sort, but we are there from there.
Ali Devjani is asking that, she's saying that I'm listening from the US. Very nice, Dr. Ali, and expecting some talk which comes in the mind for a 53 plus lady who's a homemaker.
53 is only a number, according to me. Whether you're 53 or 35 or even sweet 16 makes absolutely no difference to me. Right now, I have a very, very dear old friend who has been writing poetry, and she has requested me that, can you edit my poems and publish them for me, at least a few copies. And I'm rushing that through, because she is a young 88 right now. So I want to make sure that her book of poems is published as fast as possible. And my colleague Meera is doing wonderful work, and Sunita is doing wonderful work. They are helping me with all these things, and we are working as a team. Whatever little we can do, we are doing. So 88 is also a number, no? For all you know, she may outlive me by many years.
Yes, Sadi. And Anupama is saying some healthcare workers are unfortunately experiencing avoidance by friends, family and community.
That's really sad. Healthcare workers, municipal workers, so many such things. See, these are people who are COVID warriors, literally. It is, a reflection on, if you go back into history and read about Vietnam War, the brave young soldiers of US who went all the way to Vietnam and fought a very difficult war and came back, they were ostracized because the whole nation was rising up against the policy of USA to fight this war in Vietnam, which they had nothing to do with. But you know who they took out their anger on? They took out their anger on the soldiers who fought and came back. So history repeats itself, as I said. There are very, very insensitive people. There may be some insensitive people around you also. Like I said, you know, you give water to a municipal worker and they will stop talking to you or things of that sort. Don't bother about them. If they are open, do explain to them. But otherwise, don't bother about it. Yes, I think we are coming to the last questions. Yes. Go ahead, Seema.
Yes. So Archana is saying many elderly people are feeling insecure about their children who are abroad and they have a lot of concern. Can you please organize a separate session for them?
Why not? Why not? I think we should definitely, you know, do that. And if you could invite your children who are abroad to also come onto the same platform, maybe we can have a two-way dialogue, you know, where the parent in India expresses his or her concerns and the son or daughter who is abroad expresses their concerns, and we can act as a bridge to bring them together, and we can do that. We'll also have to probably look at the timing, because the timing varies so much from different countries. If somebody can help me to work out the timing which will be convenient to everybody, I'm definitely open to it. Please make a note of that.
Right.
Last question.
Yeah, so Anupama is saying, sad but true, stigma is more dangerous than the virus.
Yeah. Malli Rajesh says, what steps we need to take post-lockdown once it is lifted? The precaution should be there in place forever for our safety and for our surroundings. Yes, Malli, I agree with you, but that's there for everything, no? If your child steps out to go and buy ice cream, do you not take precaution that your child should cross the road properly, should look in both directions, should avoid a place where vehicles come on full speed and all that? It's an ongoing thing. Same thing with infections. Don't you tell your child, don't eat street side food because we don't know what sort of, you know, diseases or something may be there, all these things. These are all part of life. We have to do it on a regular basis. Yes, Satyavati, we will have a session for elderly, but I don't like this word elderly. I don't know who is elderly. I just told you about this friend of mine who's 88 and she definitely doesn't think that she is elderly. So we yes, but people who have lived a long time, people, you know, who come under the category of senior citizens. And as one more suggestion had come, that, you know, those who have children abroad and they are concerned about them, we will definitely tackle those issues. So you can tell people in your family or known to you who are elderly that please stand by for an announcement from us. We will have a program primarily focused on senior citizens and also their children who are abroad and anywhere. I mean, they could be in another city, they could be, but who are not there with the parent. They are equally concerned about their parents who are senior citizens, and these people are concerned about them. So we will try to bridge that gap. And with that, I think we stick to our timing. We started at 11. It is 2 minutes past 12. So I'll leave you to have a wonderful weekend, a wonderful month, wonderful year, and things of that sort. But I will see you again next week. For those who are interested about this board exam thing, I'll be interacting with you on Thursday. Otherwise, we'll be interacting on Saturday, which is going to be on a very important issue of life skills, and I'm looking forward to it.
And not just for children.
Life skills has to be learned by everybody. Thank you and bye-bye.
Thank you, Ali. So any other questions, actually, you can keep writing to us, and we will look at that and we will answer. And like Ali said, about Thursday's session, on some students who had really prepared well for the exams, and now the exams are not happening, there's some average thing that is happening. So I mean, you know, children are stressed, parents are stressed, it's a thing of concern. So Dr. Ali will address all of that on Thursday. And next Saturday's FB Live on life skills at home. So this is not just for children, but how can we practice life skills? So that is something that we can discuss and look at.
something very important. Also, I would like to say the admissions, the enrollments are on for our diploma in counseling skills. In fact, you know, we get very many calls where they said, you know, 2 years back, 3 years back, we had come for counseling and we've seen the positive effects of counseling. And now today I want to go and reach out, you know, and empower other people. So, you know, so you can be a counselor yourself, like we've been saying. You don't need a psychology background, just somebody who's compassionate, a compassionate heart who can reach out for others. So enrollments are on. So you're most welcome, you know, to come and discuss anything that is bothering you, as well as if you want to reach out to others. So see you all this coming Thursday and then on Saturday as well. So all the best, and you know, feel empowered and empower others. Thank you so much.